I'm Dr. George McGavin, and you're listening to All Creatures Small and Great, How Insects Make the World. This is an original audiobook published by W.F. Howes Limited. Prologue. I'm George McGavin. I'm a biologist and I have a particular passion for insects. Throughout my career in both academia and broadcasting, I've learned about the species you might rather disparagingly call bugs or creepy crawlies. But we undervalue and denigrate these species at our peril. Insects are amazing, and they're essential to the normal functioning of our home, planet Earth. In my lifetime, we have made enormous scientific and technological advances. The human population has risen from around 2.5 billion when I was born to over 8 billion now. The changes that have taken place on Earth during this time have been greater than at any other time in our history. I am now very worried that we have lost sight of what really matters. That is to say, I'm worried about insects. Because insects really matter. They are the most diverse and abundant group of animals that have ever lived. They have made the world. They maintain the world. But they are very rapidly disappearing from the world. In this audiobook, I want to tell you all about them. I want to tell you how important they are, how interesting and strange they can be, and why I think it's high time all of us should care deeply about their fate. Because if the creatures that made the world disappear entirely, I'm pretty sure that we will too. In creating this audiobook, I was lucky enough to spend time with a wonderful array of experts to share our passion for insects and learn from each other. At the end of the audiobook, you will be able to hear those interviews in full, as well as binaural recordings made by me of bees and other insects, as well as natural sounds. Chapter 1: The Creatures from the Blue Lagoon. It's a small world. We live on a very small and insignificant rocky planet. The Sun, an average-sized star around which we orbit, is 93 million miles away, and light from it takes a little over 8 minutes to reach us. Even at this huge distance, the Sun is very visible because it is so large and contains most of the mass of our solar system. Less than 0.25% of the mass makes up all the planets, moons, asteroids, and other stuff. Like a single particle inside a ton of finely ground flour, our Sun itself is only one of many billions of stars in the galaxy that contains it. We are mystified by extremes of magnitude and find it very hard to visualize things that are not part of our everyday experience. Things we can see and touch, and time frames that revolve around a day, a year, or a human lifespan are easy to understand. But when we start thinking about extraordinary distances or durations, it gets difficult. Lie on your back after dark, anywhere the sky is not affected by light pollution, and you will make out a bright, fuzzy band. I got my first spectacular view of our home galaxy, the Milky Way, when I was working in Tanzania on a game reserve called Mkomazi. Lying on the warm ground and staring back up at the black velvet heavens twinkling with innumerable glittering stars, I saw the broad misty streak of the Milky Way arching across the darkness. Humans have a fundamental need to understand and explain the complexities of the world around them. The ancient Greeks imagined that the Milky Way was milk that had been accidentally spilled when the goddess Hera was feeding the infant Heracles. In Hindu mythology, it is regarded as a celestial version of the sacred river Ganges. The Milky Way appears as a band in the night sky because it is a flattened disk of which our solar system is a very tiny part. Spinning at a couple of hundred kilometers per second, it is made up of somewhere between 100 billion and 400 billion stars, many of which may have a planetary system similar to ours. We now know that our solar system is located about halfway along one of the trailing arms that curve out from the center of the Milky Way, like the streaks on the surface of a stirdalati. The diameter of the Milky Way is more than 200,000 light years, and at its center is a massive black hole. Our planet is pretty inconsequential on a galactic scale, and vanishingly so on a cosmic scale. Nevertheless, the Earth is our home, and we share it with millions of other species. My thoughts on that still African night were cut short by a loud rustling much closer to home. In an instant, I was no longer concerned with the heavens above, but rather with what might be about to attack me. The safety of the Land Rover was tantalizingly close, but getting there might give my presence away. I lay absolutely still, wondering what to do. As it turned out, an aardwolf, a smaller relative of hyenas, was making its way through the undergrowth looking for food. Aardwolves are specialist insectivores with a particular penchant for termites, of which they may eat 250,000 in a single night of foraging. Thinking about these very tiny creatures brought me back down to earth. Termites are part of the most successful group of animals that has ever lived on Earth, the insects, and it is their epic story I want to tell. Humans overlook how tiny and inconsequential the Earth is compared to the vastness of space, but they also tend to overlook the importance of small creatures. Termites are integral to our world, and insects conquered the planet long ago. They were among the very first animals to appear on land, and they were the first to take to the air. Their simple but versatile body plan has allowed them to colonize every habitat on Earth, and they are staggeringly numerous. Their total biomass is at least 10 times that of all humans and our livestock combined. It is hard to imagine a terrestrial or freshwater ecosystem that does not depend on insects. The world isn't ours at all. We are newcomers on a planet made and maintained by insects. Six legs good. Insects belong to a huge group of animals called the arthropoda, species with hard outsides and lots of pairs of hinged limbs. There are four distinct groups. There are the millipedes and centipedes with elongate bodies and lots of pairs of legs, which you will find in soil and decaying wood or under stones. There are the familiar spiders and other eight-legged species, such as mites, ticks, harvestmen and scorpions. A third group comprises the crustaceans, such as shrimps, crabs, lobsters, crayfish, krill and barnacles. They are mainly marine, but there are freshwater and a few terrestrial species such as woodlice as well. The fourth, and by far the largest group, and the most successful of all the arthropods, are insects, which comprise 3/4 of all animal species and well over half of all known species. It's worth taking a little time to let that fact sink in. I have never understood how anyone could regard themselves as a zoologist without knowing about insects. Despite their overwhelming numerical superiority, It is vertebrate species that attract most academic attention and conservation effort. Insects that eat our crops and transmit diseases are feared and exterminated, while the vast majority are simply ignored. I know that many people don't like insects that much, and while they might not find bees or butterflies too much to cope with, flies, beetles, and wasps often get short shrift. So when I give public talks, I often show a slide on which there are images of several different animals. There is a bumblebee, a hornet, a couple of flies, a beetle, and even a head louse. But there is also a small image of a young bush baby. The bush baby looks dolefully at the audience with huge, wide eyes. Its tiny hands grip the fingers of the human hand that holds it aloft. The eyes of the audience are irresistibly drawn to the bush baby baby, as if the rest of the slide is completely blank. I have learned to pause for the inevitable and collective "Aww." In all the years I have used this slide, I have never not heard the "Aww" sound from an audience, and for this reason, I call the slide the "Awe Factor." The sum total of all vertebrate species, fish, birds, amphibians, reptiles, mammals, the whole beastly bestiary from aardvarks to zebras and bats to the blue whale, make up a little less than 3% of all species alive today. It is difficult not to come to the conclusion that they are a pretty trivial group of animals compared to insects. But despite this, animals with a backbone really do seem to hold a very special place in the human heart. I suppose it's easy to see how a cute bush baby would trump any number of insects. After all, bush babies are primates just like us. They have large brains, forward-facing eyes, and grasping hands with teeny little fingernails. We are hardwired to find our biological family attractive. I tell the audience that bush baby babies, adorable as they undoubtedly are pretty much superfluous in the great ecological scheme of things. And immediately I can feel the mood in the lecture room change. You'll be telling us that pandas are a complete waste of bamboo next. I merely point out that without bees, flies and beetles, the world would be totally unrecognisable. Flowering plants would go unpollinated, decaying material and dung would not be recycled, and a legion of animals, bush babies included, would not have anything to eat. The whole ecological balance of the earth is completely dependent on there being an extremely large number of insects, and it has been this way for a very long time indeed. No insects, no bush babies, no you, no me. The case of the Californian condor illustrates just how easy it can be to miss what's right under your nose. In the 20th century, through a combination of poaching, lead poisoning, and habitat destruction, the Californian condor, the biggest bird in North America, faced a very uncertain future. It could easily have gone extinct, but in 1987, when there were only 22 individuals left in the wild, a bold conservation plan was put into action. This majestic bird was worth saving. It was decided that all the wild individuals should be caught to allow a program of captive breeding to take place. The birds were very well looked after, and this included making sure that they were free of parasites. The birds were de-loused using pesticide treatments, and as a result, a unique species of bird louse that had only been scientifically described in 1963 was lost forever. There was no evidence that the lice caused the birds any discomfort at all, feeding as they do on feather fragments and skin flakes. When vertebrate species become endangered, public interest and research effort goes up. But when insects become very rare or endangered, they are simply forgotten about. It's high time we focused on the things that really matter. Just because they're small doesn't mean they're of no importance. Early days. It's hard to pinpoint exactly when I fell in love with insects. As a child, I loved looking at the distinctive black and yellow caterpillars on the nasturtiums in my grandmother's Glasgow garden. I watched them devouring the leaves and eventually pupating to become large white butterflies. There was always something interesting to find among the undergrowth, and ever since then, my eyes have been drawn to the little lives of tiny creatures. A remarkably prescient primary school teacher once wrote in the school report that a fly going past would distract me from whatever I was supposed to be doing. I'm glad to say that I still find myself distracted by flies and other insects, and I cannot imagine being interested in anything that is not part of the natural world. When I was at primary school in the 1960s, the BBC broadcast numerous programmes for schools. There was a series about prehistory and ancient history called How Things Began. In one episode, there were two children called George and Alice who discovered what life was like in the seas of the Cambrian period more than 500 million years ago. There must have been some time machine involved, and another episode was all about life in the swampy forests of the Carboniferous period 300 million years ago, and how the remains of the trees that grew then became the coal that we now used. The programme makers had hit on the idea of bringing stories to life by using dramatic presentations, and I seem to remember George and Alice crouching behind a fallen tree, watching giant dragonflies wheeling through the air above their heads. I thought it was absolutely marvellous, and as I collected the coal for the kitchen stove in the years that followed, I would be transported back to the steamy depths of a Carboniferous forest, teeming with spectacular creatures. It was much later that I realised the astonishing importance of fossils. We don't need a time machine because fossils are a record of the Earth's history that in parts is so finely detailed that it is possible to imagine how whole ecosystems must have looked and functioned millions of years before we appeared on the scene. How many species? I was born in the decade that saw the start of the space age, the jet age, and the biomolecular age. I grew up to watch the moon landing broadcast around the world and see probes sent out into the vastness of space. Since then, computers have shrunk in size and grown in power to the point that they are now ubiquitous and indispensable. Medical science has made enormous progress. Organ transplantation is now commonplace. Immunotherapy has revolutionized cancer treatment, and human cloning may be just around the corner. In my lifetime, humans have invented new ways of observing the world. At one end of the spectrum, giant machines provide proof of the existence of the infinitesimally small subatomic particles that make up matter. And at the other end, space telescopes allow us to see over astronomically large distances to image the boundaries of the cosmos and the afterglow left over from the Big Bang. But despite all these enormous advances, we still cannot answer one fundamental question. How many species are there on Earth? The first significant attempt to answer the question was carried out by the late Terry Irwin of the Smithsonian Institution. He decided that a good way to work out how many species there might be was to blast rainforest trees with a fog of fast-acting insecticide and see what dropped down. To propel the insecticide up into the treetops, he had to do a bit of rope climbing up into the forest canopy, where he deployed a portable machine known as a thermal fogger. To collect the fallout, large sheets or funnel-shaped collection trays were arranged beneath the trees. Erwin picked one species of rainforest tree in Panama and set about his mass collection effort. What he discovered was that there were 1,200 species of beetles, his specialist interest, living on this one tree species. He reckoned that only about 163 species of beetle were specific to that tree. Erwin then did a very crude extrapolation, basing his conclusion on the fact that there were another 50,000 species of rainforest trees, and it was likely that beetles made up 40% of the entire insect fauna. He concluded that it was highly likely that the number of species on Earth had been grossly underestimated, and his estimate of 30 million species caused quite a stir. It was not long before entomologists around the world were arming themselves with thermal foggers and mist blowers and killing untold numbers of insects to come up with their own estimates of how many insects there might be. Some estimates were as high as 100 million, but gradually these very high figures were revised downwards, and today the majority opinion as to how many species of arthropod there actually might be stands somewhere between 8 and 12 million. However, it was recently claimed that a trillion species might currently live on Earth, with only 0.001% described. This is due to the realization that soil, sometimes dubbed the poor man's rainforest, contains an incredibly diverse and understudied community of bacteria and other microorganisms. The difficulties in quantifying this diversity are compounded by the fact that the majority of bacteria cannot be cultured, and it is rather hard to say exactly what constitutes a bacterial species anyway. Even sticking to insects, we are still a very long way short of the finish line. Coined in the 1980s, biodiversity has become quite a buzzword. To a biologist, the word means the sum of biological variation from the level of genes and species up to ecosystems. But to most people, it simply means species richness, that is to say, the number of species found in any particular area or habitat. But measures of diversity should include both the numbers of species present and the abundance of each. Imagine two gardens. One is mainly mown lawn and decking with a few pot plants, while the other is wild and weedy. A quick and dirty half-hour survey collects 100 specimens from each garden. In the wild garden, 10 specimens of 10 different species are recorded. In the tidy, bedecked garden, there are also 10 species. They don't have to be the same as in the other garden. But here, 91 specimens belong to one species, and the 9 other species are represented by just a single individual. Both gardens have the same number of species, but the wild and weedy garden would be considered to be more diverse because the probability of the next specimen you collected being something different is much higher than in the other garden, where there is a very high probability that the next thing you encountered would be yet another specimen of the very common species already collected. You can see why most people like to deal with just the number of species. It's simple and understandable. A few species versus lots of species does mean something after all. If we're going to appreciate the massive part that insects play in the ecology of our planet, we need to understand where they came from and how they became so successful. In the beginning. A major obstacle to understanding the history of the Earth is the massive mismatch between events that take place on a human timescale and those that occur on a planetary timescale. The Earth is about one-third the age of the universe, approximately 4.5 billion years old. By chance, a football pitch is 45 meters wide. Very conveniently, therefore, a meter, about one big step, is equivalent to 100 million years, and 1 centimetre, the width of the nail of my little finger, represents 1 million years. The early Earth, formed by the slow accretion of immense quantities of dust and gas, and the sideline on one side of the pitch, is where we start. As we walk along our timeline across the pitch to the line on the other side, 4.5 billion years away, there are some important events. The first half a billion years were literally hellish. Much of the planet was still molten at this time and was constantly being knocked about by asteroids. This was also the time that a very large object the size of a small planet cannoned into the juvenile Earth, releasing a vast amount of energy and knocking great chunks of it into space. Under the gravitational pull of the Earth, this material coalesced to form the Moon, whose presence has stabilized and shaped what happens on Earth ever since. Eventually, things quietened down, the Earth's surface began to cool, and liquid water formed. Despite the desolate and forbidding conditions that had prevailed for hundreds of millions of years, our planet would not remain lifeless for long. Of course, the whole reason that life was able to arise in the first place was because the orbit of the Earth is situated in what is known as the habitable zone. It is not so far away from the Sun that it would be too cold like Mars, and neither is it too close to the Sun where it would be much too hot like Venus. This has become known as the Goldilocks effect because our planet, as the nursery story goes, was just right. This bit of serendipity means that water can exist as a gas, a liquid, or a solid, depending on where it is found. The oceans that formed on Earth soon after it began to cool may also have been topped up by extraterrestrial sources such as comets and other ice-rich objects that were flying around the young solar system. Some of the chemical building blocks of life, including organic molecules, may have arrived from space carried by comets and asteroids, and so far, more than 140 biologically relevant molecules have been identified. In addition, intact amino acids, the building blocks of proteins, have been found in the remains of meteorites. In one study that simulated the conditions found in deep space, it has been possible to generate small structures that look very much like cell walls, an important step in containing and isolating all the chemical reactions that must take place inside a cell. The rise of oxygen. Biologically speaking, nothing much happened for 5 or 6 meters from the start of our football pitch traversing timeline, but now there are beginnings of life in the fossil record. Single-celled organisms have appeared, but it is not until we reach halfway across the pitch that the atmosphere becomes rich in oxygen. This took place sometime between 2.5 and 3 billion years ago due to the appearance of the first photosynthetic organisms, the best known of which are the cyanobacteria. These ancient microorganisms lived in shallow seas and had evolved the biochemical trick of making their own food by capturing the sun's energy. The generation of oxygen as a waste product was to change the world completely. Cyanobacteria grew in thin, mat-like layers, binding grains of the substrate together. The upshot of all this oxygen being pumped out was that things got pretty toxic for all the anaerobic microorganisms that already existed. And as levels of oxygen in the atmosphere increased, the ancient bacteria for which oxygen was pure poison were relegated to peculiar refuges. Very few multicellular organisms today are anaerobes, and those that are confined to deep-sea habitats where they use hydrogen as an energy source. As far as we can tell, The trick of capturing the energy from the sun occurred only once, and the descendants of these early cyanobacteria are still with us today. Trees, plants, anything that photosynthesizes. It took quite a while for oxygen to become abundant in the atmosphere because as soon as it was produced, it was immediately removed by chemically reacting with various rocks and minerals. But eventually, after millions of years, there was enough surplus being produced that oxygen began to accumulate. Some of the oxygen became ozone in the upper atmosphere, and this meant that for the first time in the Earth's history, the harmful effects of ultraviolet radiation were greatly reduced. More cells are better than one. Life on Earth remained generally small and microscopic until about 600 million years ago, a mere six steps from the sideline on the other side of the pitch, when complex multicellular life appears. These soft-bodied organisms did not fossilize very well, and they were not really like anything that exists today. There were worm-like creatures with segmented bodies, frond-like things and rounded or oval structures that might all have been filter feeders of some kind. Complex organisms are made up of different types of cells, and multicellularity, which has evolved many times, has many advantages. For a start, multicellular organisms can get much bigger, and there are economies of scale to be had from having different cells carrying out different specific functions. The division of labor itself leads to more specialization. But multicellularity relies above all else on communication and cooperation between cells. There would be no point if a nerve cell stopped being a nerve cell, or if gut cells decided they might do better plowing their own furrows somewhere else. And of course, all cells need to know when they are surplus to requirement. Cell death needs to be built into the system. Cancer is an example of what can happen when the strict regulation of cells breaks down and cells, once working for the common good, start behaving like independent agents looking out for themselves. Nearly 3 years ago, a single mutation in a skin cell of my right heel caused it to begin to reproduce uncontrollably. The cells simply didn't know when to die. Fortunately for me, the science of genetics was able to pinpoint exactly what that mutation was, and a number of drugs became available to block the metabolic pathways within the affected cells. Three cheers for science and the power of the human imagination, and all done at impressive speed, given that the structure and function of DNA itself was barely understood in the year I was born. Some early multicellular life forms were radially symmetrical. That is to say, their bodies showed a repeating pattern around a central axis, like jellyfish and sea anemones. This body plan works pretty well in a marine environment, and these creatures spent their time bumbling about looking for food in the sea or were fixed to the substrate and waited for food to come their way. But a much better body plan, and one that is seen in the vast majority of organisms today, from earthworms to elephants and bumblebees to birds, is to be bilaterally symmetrical along the longitudinal plane. The first fossil animals with bilateral symmetry would become the predominant life form. Having a clearly defined front and back gives an organism a clear direction of travel. The front part of the body becomes endowed with various sensory organs to measure different aspects of the environment ahead, and the mouth is well placed to consume whatever food may be encountered. Nervous tissue to deal with all this sensory input becomes concentrated at the front end, and gradually the different parts of the body become specialized for different sorts of tasks. Further minor modifications allow for various limbs to provide propulsion and other appendages for food gathering and processing. Now, at last, there is a world-beating pattern that evolution can endlessly tweak and refine. The creatures from the Blue Lagoon. Things really start to get interesting about 5.5 meters from the end of our football pitch timeline, about 550 million years ago. The Earth's oceans fill up with all manner of complex organisms. The Cambrian explosion, as it is known, saw the relatively sudden appearance in the fossil record of the ancestors of all species alive today. The reason we know a lot more about the last 500 million years or so of Earth's history is mainly because species developed hard parts reinforced with calcium carbonate, perhaps in response to increased levels of predation. This meant that their remains fossilized much more easily, and this has given us a much more detailed picture of what was going on. This is where the arthropod story really takes off. Popularly known as the Big Bang of biology, the fauna of the Cambrian period has been well characterized thanks also to the discovery of some exceptional fossil deposits around the world, where the preservation is so fine that minute details of the animals can be seen. These deposits may have formed when a sudden collapse of fine sediment buried the creatures beneath instantaneously. In the right conditions, where oxygen was excluded and any decay stopped, the buried creatures would remain intact long enough for a good impression to be left in the sedimentary rock that it would become part of. The finer the particles of sediment, the finer will be the resulting fossil, rather like the degree of resolution in a digital image. These very special fossil finds have given us a series of snapshots of times long ago. With a little imagination, we can swim in the warm Cambrian seas and marvel at the diversity of trilobites and other strange arthropod creatures. Up to this point, every living thing is marine, but 4.75 meters from the end of our timeline, 475 million years ago, the first land plants appear, accompanied by some of the creatures from the Blue Lagoons. These creatures became land living, and a short time later, in geological terms at any rate, they took to the skies. These first terrestrial arthropods did not emerge suddenly from the sea to live on the land, but probably made a very gradual progression by first living around the fringes of permanently wet coastal areas in habitats such as mats of algae and biofilms growing on rocks. Numerous trackways and trace fossils showing parallel rows of marks made by legs with a central line of broken marks, perhaps made by the end of an abdomen, have been interpreted as having been made by walking arthropods as they moved along a shoreline. They might have accompanied the spread of algae and other species as they too slowly colonized the land. A common view has been that the invasion of the land by the early arthropods took place after the appearance of land plants, but it might well have happened more or less at the same time, as fossil finds suggest that early food chains comprising scavengers, herbivores, and predators were already in place. But whatever the exact timing, the early arthropods emerged from the sea and made the transition to land, probably in order to escape a marine environment full of other species wanting to eat them. They may have had an amphibious habit of moving between scattered salty pools. They were without doubt small and fast-breeding creatures, and the insects we know today are their descendants. Of course, along our timeline, there have been extinction events, some of them very large indeed, such as the one that marks the end of the Permian period 250 million years ago, and only 2.5 meters from the far sideline point on our timeline, when a great majority of the Earth's organisms perished. Despite this, every living species today had an ancestor that made it through this and other cataclysmic events. The dinosaurs, the largest land animals ever to have lived on Earth, and which had dominated their environment for 135 million years, were seen off by the impact of a large asteroid at least 10 kilometres across, smashing into the Earth about 66 million years ago. The impact left a crater 180 kilometres wide and resulted in massive tidal waves, fires and shock waves that triggered widespread earthquakes and volcanism. Acid rain and poor sunlight would have destroyed ecosystems worldwide and caused the extinction of three quarters of the plant and animal species on Earth at that time. Large creatures did not fare very well, but small creatures survived. I like to imagine a small shrew-like creature startled by the massive fireball, brighter than a thousand suns, running for cover in an underground burrow. If they had not, human beings would not exist. We have now walked almost the whole way across our 45-metre-wide football pitch, and the first hominid species that walked upright appears just 3 centimetres, about the width of a fat thumb, from the line on the other side, 3 million years ago. Human beings, anatomically indistinguishable from us today, appear in the last 2 millimetres, the width of a 2-pence coin, from the opposite side of the pitch. That's us. We really are the new kids on the block, and the whole of our recorded history occupies a paltry 5,000 years, which on our football pitch-wide timeline is about half the thickness of a sheet of gold leaf. You could imagine that the appearance of life on Earth is a completely unique occurrence, a colossal fluke. Or perhaps life is very common indeed. It has been suggested that as many as 4% of the billions of stars in our own galaxy have rocky planets orbiting them within the habitable zone where water might be available. If you factor in the 2 trillion or so other galaxies in the universe, you cannot escape the conclusion that life must exist in innumerable other places. There are good reasons why insects are so very abundant on Earth. They have a versatile, lightweight and waterproof exoskeleton which protects them and keeps them from drying up. Being generally small animals, they can occupy a much larger percentage of any ecological space available. They have an efficient nervous system with an effective blood-brain barrier to keep their vital nervous system insulated from biochemical fluctuations within their fluid-filled bodies. And they have absolutely phenomenal powers of reproduction. But for all their jaw-dropping diversity, insects are remarkably similar in overall design, inside and out. The ancient blueprint, 500 million or more years old, has proved a good one, and evolution has tweaked it over and over again to produce a multitude of variants based on 3 main sections, the head, thorax, and abdomen. If you were given the task of making a self-sustaining, self-replicating piece of miniature machinery that could survive in widely differing environments, it would necessarily look a lot like an insect. In the next chapter, we will examine the details of the insect blueprint to discover what it is about these small creatures that have made them the most phenomenally successful, enduring, and diverse group of organisms our planet has ever seen. Sir David Attenborough has long held a fascination with the history of life on our planet, and I have been inspired and informed by his work over the years. We spoke about the vital role of insects and how we can protect the future of life on Earth for humans and animals alike.
If you're a natural history broadcaster, you know that there are kids who, you know, that young kids are going to start off in the beginning of looking at the natural world, and they look at birds, you know, and then they look at furry things, And by the time they're 8, 10, 12, those are the things that become dominant. But it's not so in now 6-year-olds. It's not so in 4-year-olds. I remember taking a godson of mine when he was about 5 across a field in Oxfordshire to look at natural world. You see? And there were big stones in the pasture. And I said, well, turn them over and see what's underneath. And he went to one and he turned it over and he said, oh, look, what a treasure, a slug. And of course, he's right. I mean, you know, and he was fascinated. Can it see? What are those things that's sticking out of the front? How does it feed? How does it move? And when you're 4 or 5, you have no prejudices on the matter. You just, it's wonderful. And that innocence of I is so precious, in fact. And we all go through that, but there are lots of other things in this wide, wonderful world which take us away. But we ought never to lose that first thing.
Do you think we've lost our connection with the real world, as I call it, the natural world?
Yeah, we know we are. I mean, we know the United Nations statistics and all that sort of stuff tell us that the majority of the human race are urbanised.
In this chapter, I discussed how my fascination with insects began in childhood. Discovering nature and the outside world at a young age is crucial to creating adults that are compassionate towards the natural world, whatever career path they embark on. I was delighted to chat to Alison Steadman, beloved British actress and ambassador for the London Wildlife Trust, about her love of the natural world.
As a child, growing up, I grew up in Liverpool, in the suburbs of Liverpool, but we had a nice garden, not a big garden, but a very nice garden. My dad was a keen gardener. All my family were into gardening, birds, insects. You know, my two grandmas, I had an aunt who would teach me about things. And so I was constantly interested. And my favourite thing was to crawl around the garden. My dad grew rhubarb and there was always, you know, caterpillars and things. And I would be, you know, spotting the caterpillars. And we had a wonderful guy who was mending our garden fence, I remember. And I came along with a caterpillar that was brown with the fur, just brown fur, you know, and I loved this. And I showed it to him. And this chap, he said to me, you know those things in Africa? They're the size of scarves. They wear them as scarves.
You'd have a very itchy skin.
And I was only about 5, and I remember thinking, really? Scarves? And then he said, see that rhubarb? They use the rhubarb in their Africa as umbrellas because it's so big. They're so big, the rhubarb. They just walk round with a rhubarb leaf over their heads. And he was just great, this guy, you know. Those are sort of really happy memories. But yeah, I absolutely loved it. The only time I was ever frightened as a child was I got in the bath and my mum gave me a loofah. That's what we used to call them. I don't know, you know, a loofah. To, you know, wash myself. And I put it in the water and an earwig came out from inside the loofah and was floating around in the water. And I didn't like that. That was scary. They are quite scary. Gosh, I never see an earwig now. I haven't seen one for years and years. But they were very frequent, you know, around the house.
Alison went on to forge a successful acting career. But for others, that first curiosity about the natural world can blossom into a lifelong mission. Sir David Attenborough told me about his early experiences. You've been in this business for a long time, and you must have had a fascination for animals from a pretty early age. Were insects uppermost in your mind, or were they just little extras?
The thing that obsessed me as a boy, certainly from 6, 7, 8, certainly, were fossils. I grew up in the Midlands in Leicestershire, And in the east of Leicestershire, there's a lovely oolitic limestone, Jurassic, full of ammonites. And also small little things called rinconella, which were the size of a hazelnut, and with a zigzag jaw between the two valves and so on. You started those in the same way as you started when you were eight, collecting bus tickets, or which we don't have anymore. But you know the sort of thing. But suddenly, forming a collection of these and then working out that some of them were the same and some of them were different, and what were the differences and which were common and which weren't and why, that sort of thing just obsessed me from... Not in the early years. In the early years, it was getting them all together and seeing how many you could get and what the variations were. But that was what took me out to eastern Leicestershire on my bicycle day after day after day during the summer.
The footpath that winds from the Dorset village of Worth Mortravers south to Winspit Bay is about 1 mile long. It must be one of my favourite walks, and I've been doing it now and then for nearly 40 years. Leaving the village, the path takes you past a hedgerow thick with honeysuckle and bramble, and across some fields. On the hillsides, as you descend towards the sea, are ancient earth terraces, built to make the most of the land, their outlines now much softened by rain and time. The footpath joins the coastal path eventually, and if you turn right at this point, you will immediately find a disused quarry. The Portland stone hewn from the quarry at Winspit was lowered down to waiting boats, transported to Swanage, and then on to London. These days, the abandoned workings which attract tourists and climbers are also home to mouse-eared and greater horseshoe bats. If you turn left, the coast path runs east towards Seacombe Cliff and Dancing Ledge. But if you negotiate the steep scramble towards the sea, you will find broad, flat ledges of rock. If the tide is out, you will be able to clamber a fair way round the side of the cliff, and here, under rock overhangs and in shaded crevices, you will find a quite remarkable insect called the sea bristletail. Anne Riley and myself spent a little while on the coast at Winspit, and it didn't take us very long to find jumping bristletails all over the cliff rocks. So, Anne, we've come down from Worth Mortravers to the coast, about a mile and a half, 2 miles, and we're in this rocky little sea cave. The sea is lapping at the entrance here. And we've come for a very special reason, haven't we?
We've come for a very special reason. You're going to show me some really interesting ancient creatures.
Absolutely. Well, these rocks are covered in very ancient insects called bristletails. And they've obviously just had their young in the last few weeks, because everywhere you look, there are little tiny bristletails.
Yeah, I can see all these little things scurrying all over the rocks.
Here's one here.
Various.
There's one there.
Sizes. Oh yeah.
Oh no.
Oh no. Oh, it's
yeah.
Oh,
that's a skin.
Skin. Yeah.
Okay, so
skin.
That one's a shed skin.
Oh, that's the one. Very young one.
There's a very young one there, and they are wingless. They've always been so. And what I find absolutely remarkable about these things is that they are virtually unchanged in form and function for something like 400 million years. So, I mean, to be able to find insects like this just on the coast here, I think is quite remarkable.
So it must have been a pretty brilliant design all that time ago, not to need modifying. And so are you saying that they're still unchanged from how they were?
It's a sort of version of if it ain't bust, don't fix it. You know, they have lived in these environments in the northern hemisphere, rocky coasts like this, where there is algae and stuff to eat, and they're just here. Now you live up in Yorkshire, which does not have a coastline.
No, right in the middle of the country.
So you would have to go quite a way to find these insects?
Yeah, east or west, it's quite a way. So it's a real treat to come somewhere like this on a lovely day.
And now, if we've got our hand lens, I don't know if you can see, but sideways on, you can see that they've got three pairs of legs, like insects do. But underneath, along the abdomen, they've got little styles. They're little accessory organs which help them move fast over the rocks. And at the rear end, they've got three slender tails. This species lives on rocky shores in the Northern Hemisphere, where after dark it grazes lichens and algae growing in the rocks. These hardy little creatures, which are no more than 1.5 centimetres long, appear at first glance a rather drab greyish brown. But seen close up, they are quite beautiful. The elongate body is covered with minute scales which glint as they scurry and jump about. The head has a pair of noticeable compound eyes, and the thorax, which is slightly humped, bears three pairs of legs. The rear end of the body has three long, slender filaments, and the underside of the abdominal segments each have a pair of tiny projections called styles to help them get around. Bristletails belong to an insect order known as the Archaeognatha, literally old jaws, and they've been around for 400 million years or so. They are wingless, just like their ancestors that were scurrying around in the Devonian period when land plants and terrestrial ecosystems were just becoming established. The period saw the appearance of the first ferns, the first horsetails, as well as the first seed-bearing plants. The bristletails on the rocks at Windspit are very similar indeed to their Devonian ancestors, and as far as we can tell, have a similar lifestyle. The other thing that makes these insects remarkable is that most insects, when they molt for the last time and become adult, that's it, they won't shed their skin again. But with these bristletails, they just keep on growing. They just molt and molt and molt and molt, up to 50 times, 80 times, and they get bigger every time. And they are sexually mature at some point, but continue to grow and shed their skin. That's pretty unique among insects today. The fact that they have stayed pretty much the same for several hundred million years is surprising, especially when you consider that the Devonian period was also when the first vertebrate animals, our forebears, the tetrapods, crawled out of the seas on fin-like limbs. But why have these remarkable insects stayed the same? Rocky seaside habitats have existed for a very long time, as have the algae that the bristletails eat. Perhaps bristletails are just well adapted to the environment in which they live and have been able to track any changes over time. Bristletails are perhaps an evolutionary example of the old adage, if it ain't bust, don't fix it. Chapter 2. Brilliant Bodies. The remarkable diversity of insects and their spectacular success is only possible because of their incomparable design. I wish there was a word which did not suggest a designer or creator other than the persistent and pervasive power of evolution through natural selection. Millions of years of refinement has produced the ultimate survivor. And it would be difficult to imagine a more adaptable and versatile animal than an insect. Many of the ancestors of insects had more segments and more legs, but no one region of the body was particularly specialised except the head. The trouble with this arrangement is that it is not very efficient, and is partly why there are 100 times more insect species alive today than there are millipedes and centipedes. Over time, a more advantageous arrangement would evolve where the segments of the body became grouped into different functional sections. The advantage of this amalgamation of segments is that each group of segments could become a specialised region for different tasks. Evolution has tweaked the ancient insect blueprint over hundreds of millions of years to produce a multitude of variants based on three main sections: the head, the thorax, and the abdomen. The insect head is the command center. It is formed from six fused segments and carries a pair of compound eyes comprising a large number of individual light-gathering units, secondary light receptive organs called ocelli, and a pair of antennae. It also carries the mouth parts, which are variously modified to allow the sucking of liquids or the chewing of solid food. The thorax, made up of three segments, is the powerhouse of the insect. Each segment bears a pair of legs, and the rear two segments typically each have a pair of wings. The abdomen, which is usually made up of 11 segments, contains the digestive system and reproductive organs. And that's it. Head, thorax with wings and legs, abdomen. It's a compact and easily modifiable arrangement. In life, the internal organs of insects are immersed in a plasma-like fluid called hemolymph that acts as a multi-purpose chemical transport system. This arthropod version of blood is pumped from the back of the body to the front by an open-ended tube-like heart lying along the dorsal surface. The digestive system of insects is pretty much like that of many other animals. It's essentially a tube. The front part of the gut has specialized regions for grinding and storing food. The midgut is the main area for enzyme production and the absorption of nutrients, and the hindgut gets rid of wastes. Like all animals, insects need carbohydrates, fats, proteins, and vitamins to survive and grow. Plant foods, especially sap, can be very low in protein, and sap-sucking insects may have to eat large amounts to meet their requirements. Herbivorous insects can be quite fussy, and most are restricted to eating one plant or a few closely related ones. This is not true of the desert locust, you might think. One of the most damaging insects on the planet, this species is capable of forming immense crop-devouring swarms comprising billions of individuals. They have a reputation of being able to eat just about anything. But the reality is that they are rather careful what they eat. It turns out that they are not gourmands, but gourmets. Research on their feeding behaviour shows that they regulate their food intake very well, and much better than we do if left to our own devices, and eat carbohydrates, fats, and especially protein in accordance with what they need at any time. No one knows more about insect nutrition than Professor Steve Simpson, and I spoke to him about his groundbreaking work on locust feeding.
Locusts, which are a group of accreted grasshoppers that all share this remarkable capability of, if crowded, they change, quite literally change their behaviour, their shape, their colour, such that they become swarming rather than solitary, non-swarming grasshoppers. And that switch between the solitary and the swarming form is at the heart of the locust problem, which faces about 1 in 10 people on Earth impacted by locust swarms. And you might think, if you were going to look at an animal and try and understand its appetite system, what determines when it eats and what it eats, you would find a locust would be basically as voracious and non-considered in its nutritional choices as any animal.
Yes, if you asked anybody what a locust was, they would say, well, it just eats everything. It just clears everything.
And en masse it will. So if you take 100 billion locusts, then they'll eat the same amount of food as the population of London will in a week. But every single locust, it turns out, is exquisitely able to balance its nutrition. It knows what to eat, when to eat. And I started a project as a PhD student, which was looking into this problem. And it took me all the way from delivering Vaseline enemas to locusts to try and find out whether they had stretch receptors in their recta, all the way through to experiments where I was teasing apart some of the behavioral cues that they use and their rhythms of feeding and so forth. Now, that study, which was my PhD at the University of London, then led me to a postdoc where I decided I'd try and move to a more complex animal and look at its feeding neurophysiology. And I went into working on monkeys in an experimental psychology department at Oxford, and soon discovered that if I was going to get fundamental answers about how an organism made nutritional decisions, it was far easier to go back to insects, exactly as you say. So I did. I went back to my locus system in zoology at Oxford and then started to really uncover the fundamentals of appetite. So it turns out that locusts and other insects don't just feel hungry or full. They have specific appetites for different nutrients, protein, carbohydrate, salt, for example. And that early discovery, which then led to trying to understand the mechanisms that control those sorts of separate appetites, turned out to be fundamental. And working with a PhD student who arrived in 1987, David Robenheimer, and you know David well.
I know David well,
We were colleagues. We developed a new way of looking at nutrition based on our study of locust feeding behavior. And that new way of looking at specific appetites and their interactions led us to discover that not only locusts and other insects have specific appetites for different nutrients, so too do all animals, including humans. And we discovered that if you put those appetites together in an environment where they're forced to compete with one another, so the appetite for fats and carbohydrates and protein, for example, aren't working together to help the organism to balance its diet as they do in natural food environments, but rather in an imbalanced nutritional environment, such as the modern human environment, food environment, then these appetites are forced to compete. And we showed that protein is the dominant appetite.
Which sort of makes sense, because that's what you need to build to build your eggs, to build your larvae.
That's right.
You need protein.
That's right. You need protein because protein contains nitrogen, and the nitrogen is the essential element when it comes to building new tissues and maintaining them and reproducing and everything else that matters in life. So you need calories and you need nitrogen, and those two things, plus all the other micronutrients, are really embedded in the appetite systems that are possessed of all animals, including ourselves. And we then went on to propose that perhaps dilution of protein in the human food supply, which is what's happened over the last 50 years or 60 years as a result of the incorporation of vast quantities of highly processed fats and carbohydrates in the form of ultra-processed foods, and that's been the principal feature of the human food system over the last 50, 60 years. Maybe the fact that our appetite for protein makes sure that we eat the same target amount day on day is what's driving overconsumption of total energy and hence leading to obesity and everything else that goes with it.
So what you're saying,
and that's
in essence, is if you as a human being are faced with this modern smorgasbord of processed food, which has attractive elements, you like the taste of salt, you like the taste of fat, but it hasn't got much protein in it, your brain's saying, we're not getting our protein here. You have to eat more of this to to get your target protein.
That's precisely right. And if that highly processed food tastes like protein, but actually is only fat and carbs. In other words, if it's a barbecue flavored potato chip, which has all the sensory cues of a high protein food, umami and salt and all those flavors that we've evolved to associate with protein in foods, if you're seeking protein and you've got those available, you'll eat them. And you'll get no protein, and your protein appetite will be saying, you haven't eaten any, keep going. And overall, you're going to have to eat more calories to get your target level of protein. And this idea, which was originally called the protein leverage hypothesis when we published it in 2005, has now been shown to be consistent with the evidence across global populations for the emergence and the continuation of the obesity epidemic. Now, that was an insight that's had profound implications for human health, but it came from sitting down watching locusts making food choices as an entomologist, but a curious entomologist with an interest in a bigger biological question, which was, why do we eat what we eat?
It's a fantastic story, and one that completely shows that you don't have to work on large, hairy animals. You if you want answers and you want them quick and you want them to be good, work on insects. And here is an underlying, almost a rule, of being an animal.
Six superpowers. To understand why insects are such successful animals, we need to examine a number of key features. Insects have six superpowers that have helped them thrive. Because they are arthropods, they have a protective exoskeleton. They are generally small creatures that survive better than large ones. They have an efficient nervous system that suited their transition to dry land, coupled with a fantastic ability to sense their environment. They evolved the power of flight, making them the ultimate colonizers and escape artists. Finally, they are prolific and reproduce at an extraordinary rate. Advanced armor. The shapes of some insects can seem completely fantastical, so bizarre, in fact, that it is sometimes difficult to imagine how or why they look the way they do. I have been lucky enough to see some of the weirdest looking of all insects at first hand. It had been a long and tiring day involving three flights. Heathrow in London to Chicago and then on to Miami and eventually to the International Airport in Belize. After a four-hour drive, I arrived at the Las Cuevas field station, situated in the heart of the Chicxulub Forest Reserve, the largest protected area in Belize. It was August 2001, and I had come to Belize to search for sap-sucking bugs called tree hoppers. Related to cicadas and plant hoppers, what makes these insects so remarkable is that they are truly masters of disguise. I had first seen tree hoppers a few years before in the entomological collections of the Oxford University Museum of Natural History, where I worked. The polished mahogany cabinet that housed them contained half a dozen drawers of tree hoppers. I opened the first drawer and peered at the specimens pinned inside. Tree hoppers are quite small insects, and I decided to carry the drawers down to my office where I could look at them under a stereo binocular microscope. I spent the rest of the afternoon very happily taking specimen after specimen out of the drawers in order to examine them. It was very clear that these specimens had not been handled in a very long time because some of the pins were hard to pull from the cork base of the drawer. Much of the material seemed to have been collected in the 19th and 20th century, and there had been very few additions to the collections in the last 50 years. Some of these tree hoppers looked like plant thorns, while others looked like seeds. But the most interesting specimens in the drawers looked a bit like ants. Tree hoppers, of which there are around 3,500 species, are especially diverse in South America and exhibit some of the most freakish shapes seen in the insect world. In some insects, several parts of the body can look leaf-like or stick-like, but with tree hoppers, the weird and wonderful modifications that camouflage them are confined to just one part of the body, the back or dorsal surface of the first segment of the thorax, which can be greatly enlarged and contorted. Some species have a long projection from which other projections branch off horizontally, each with a small ball attached. In others, the whole thing looks like an ant with its jaws held wide open. These elaborate structures, which often look much bigger than the tree hoppers themselves, have no obvious function but to conceal the rest of the tree hopper. They look bulky, but they are in fact hollow and lightweight. Whatever the cost to the individual tree hopper in terms of the energy required to make such a thing and to carry it around, the advantages must be considerable. Tree hoppers may look pretty obvious pinned in neat rows in a museum drawer, but in their shaded rainforest habitat, they can be hard to spot. Their portable camouflage protects them from hungry birds and may even have become part of the way different species recognize a potential mate. As I gazed down the microscope at the weird shapes, I wondered what might have been the evolutionary path that led from plain unadorned tree hopper to these carnivalesque creatures. Imagine a population of ancestral tree hoppers. They are small and unremarkable. By chance, a mutation arises that gives one of the tree hoppers a small spine-like process on the back of the first thoracic segment. Because of how it now looks, naive birds and other diurnal predators might avoid it more often than not. This individual survives to produce slightly more offspring than the normal-looking tree hoppers. Predation is a powerful selective pressure, and over hundreds of generations, the small spine becomes enlarged, and in 1,000 generations, it can assume all manner of shapes, just so long as each step along the way looks increasingly inedible. These brilliant bodies demonstrate one of the keys to survival, not looking like anything else's next meal. Another defining feature of the arthropods is the covering that separates their insides from the outside. It's called cuticle, and it's made of something called chitin. Cuticle covers the whole of the outside of the insect and also extends inside, where it lines the foregut, the hindgut, and even the major branches of the tracheal system, by which means air enters the body. The chitin molecules are embedded in a protein matrix to make a tough composite material. In parts where extra toughness and protection are important, the outer layer of the cuticle can be tanned or hardened. This is an irreversible process caused by adjacent protein chains becoming chemically cross-linked. The resulting material can form the hardest wing cases of beetles, as well as claws and mandibles capable of cutting through hardwood and even some metals. Areas that need to be soft and flexible, such as the joints between legs and segments, remain soft and pliable. One of the major problems of life on land is that exposed to sun and wind, you can start to dry out. To combat this, the very outermost layer of an insect's cuticle is waterproofed with a thin layer of wax. But the cuticle of an insect is a very different thing from a simple suit of armour. It is capable of a degree of self-repair and, importantly, forms an exoskeleton providing anchor points to which the internal musculature is attached. The cuticle also provides protection from the biological warfare waged against insects by viruses, bacteria, and fungi, and in many cases is able to mount an immune response to these pathogens by producing antibacterial proteins. Modern science has come up with all kinds of composite materials which are both strong and lightweight. But nothing we have manufactured yet quite matches the versatility and effectiveness of an insect's cuticle. But of course, having a tough exoskeleton brings its own problems. Vertebrate animals have an internal skeleton which grows as they do. A big drawback for creatures with a skeleton on the outside is that it needs to be renewed from time to time to allow for growth. Some insects molt as few as 3 or 4 times during their life, while others may do so 50 or more times. There are dangers in molting, as for a short time, the protective function of the cuticle is severely compromised. If you have ever spent time sitting near water, you may have seen a fully grown dragonfly nymph crawling slowly up a plant stem to begin shedding its skin. The first time you witness an insect molting to the adult stage, it can seem utterly mysterious and otherworldly. I have never met anyone who has not been fascinated and absorbed by this remarkable process, one that has been repeated trillions upon trillions of times since arthropod animals first arose. It truly is one of the wonders of the natural world. When molting begins, the cells of the epidermis draw back from the inner surface of the old cuticle. The surface of the epidermis increases by cells dividing and, having a greater area, now appears wrinkled. This is important as the surface area of the epidermis determines the surface area of the cuticle it will eventually secrete. Then, a special fluid, a mixture of enzymes, is secreted into the space between the epidermis and the old cuticle, which begins to be digested and reabsorbed. The fluid cannot attack the toughest parts of the cuticle, which will be eventually shed. Once the epidermal cells have secreted a new cuticle, the process of shedding the old one can take place, and the insect must expand the new cuticle before it hardens. Size matters. Why are insects generally small creatures? Why are there no cat-sized cockroaches or dog-sized dung beetles? You may be very glad there are neither. Although some of the largest insects can be bigger and even feed on some of the world's smallest vertebrates, there are good mechanical and biological reasons why insects cannot be larger than they are. The size range of all organisms covers 8 orders of magnitude. The smallest bacterial cell, at around 0.3 millionths of a millimetre, is 10 times smaller than the finest strand of spider silk. The largest animal ever to have lived is a blue whale, 30 metres in length. In the middle of this range, with an average length of around 3 millimetres, are the insects. There are, of course, insects that are larger and smaller than the 3 millimetre average. Goliath beetles found in African forests can be up to 110 millimetres in length. They sit neatly in the human hand and weigh between 60 to 100 grams, which makes them heavier than many birds. A few butterflies and moths have very large wingspans, up to 280 millimetres across, but their bodies are small. The longest species of insect in the world, a stick insect found in Southeast Asia, has a body length of around 320 millimetres, about the length of a human forearm. The smallest insects are species of parasitic wasp that lay their eggs inside the eggs of other insects. Although winged, these minuscule creatures are a little more than 0.2 millimetres from head to tail. That is about half the size of some single-celled organisms, such as an amoeba. One of the smallest beetles in the world today is a tiny feather-winged species that could balance quite easily on the claw tip of a Goliath beetle. That insects use the same body plan across a large range of sizes gives them an unrivaled versatility. In my travels, I have seen some impressively large insects, some of which have tried to take a chunk out of my fingers. But on an African field trip some years ago, I collected a truly tiny wasp that I thought could take on the all-comers record for the smallest insect on Earth. I couldn't measure it accurately in the field and made the rookie error of mentioning my discovery to a journalist before I had checked my facts. On my return to Oxford, I got phone calls from several local and national newspapers asking to see the wasp. I had to confess that it would take me some time to locate the specimen among the masses of specimen tubes I had brought back. A national paper ran a story the next day with a cartoon of a balding, bespectacled, white-coated scientist with a puzzled expression holding up an empty flask. The caption read, "I've found the world's smallest insect. Oh dear, where is it?" That an insect less than a millimetre long can exist and function is a fantastic example of the success of the insect blueprint. The tiny wasp I had collected has exactly the same organs, working in exactly the same way as the giant spider-hunting wasps I would sometimes see patrolling the savannah to find their next victim. These wasps differ in mass perhaps by 1,000 times, but they have the same nuts and bolts and are both part of the ecological machinery that makes the world tick. Insects were not always small. There is ample fossil evidence that in the late Carboniferous period, many arthropods were much bigger than they are today. They might not have been as big as the monsters dreamed up by makers of horror films, but...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.